Amen. We need to remember Brother Reuben as he is away in revival this week, or starting tonight at Bethel and Bastrop. So remember him in your prayers. One announcement I need to make is that there will be a funeral here tomorrow for Donna Gay Nolan. I believe she would have been my mom's first cousin. She passed away, and her funeral, I think the visitation is at 10 tomorrow. The funeral will follow at 11, and then I think they'll be feeding the family at noon, but the church won't be feeding. It'll be just their family, or part of our family will be feeding them. So that'll be going on tomorrow here at Antioch for that family. So remember them in your prayers. It's good to be here tonight. I appreciate Brother Reuben giving the opportunity to preach. My wife can attest to this. I've been, for whatever reason, a little more nervous this time than I usually am. And then I look at the crowd, and there's nothing to be nervous about. I mean, kind of a little bit slim tonight. My Sunday school is this big sometimes, almost, maybe. But anyway, it's good to be here tonight and to speak to you. I had a Miss Mildred joke, but I don't see her, so I'll save it for Sunday morning. And we'll do that. We'll catch her one day. So anyway, it's been good lately here at Antioch. The services we've had, God has really blessed, and he's really moved lately. And, you know, it's not always that way. And it's just been refreshing to me. It's really helped me in my walk. And so I hope you feel the same way. But tonight we want to look at this subject, when Jesus passes by. And we'll be looking tonight in John chapter 4. John chapter 4, if you have your Bibles, my glasses are so dirty I can't see. John chapter 4, we'll read through verse 26, rather lengthy here, but I think we need to get it all here. It says, "When therefore the Lord knew how the Pharisees had heard that Jesus made and baptized more disciples than John, though Jesus himself baptized not, but his disciples, he left Judea and departed again into Galilee." Verse 4, "And he must needs go through Samaria. Then cometh he to a city of Samaria, which is called Sychar, near to the parcel of ground that Jacob gave to his son Joseph. And now Jacob's well was there, and Jesus therefore, being wearied with his journey, sat thus on the well, and it was about the sixth hour. And there cometh a woman of Samaria to draw water, and Jesus saith unto her, Give me to drink, for his disciples were gone away into the city to buy meat. In verse 9, then saith the woman of Samaria unto him, How is it that thou, being a Jew, askest drink of me, which am a woman of Samaria? For the Jews have no dealings with the Samaritans. And Jesus answered and said unto her, If thou knewest the gift of God, and who it is that saith to thee, Give me to drink, thou wouldest ask of him, and he would have given thee living water. The woman saith unto him, Sir, thou hast nothing to draw with, and the well is deep. From whence, then, hast thou that living water? Art thou greater than our father Jacob, which gave us the well, and drank thereof himself, and his children, and his cattle? And Jesus answered and said unto her, Whosoever drinketh of this water shall thirst again. But whosoever drinketh of the water that I shall give him shall never thirst. But the water that I shall give him shall be in him a well of water springing up into eternal life," or everlasting life. "The woman saith unto him, Sir, give me this water, that I thirst not, neither come hither to draw. And Jesus saith unto her, Go, call thy husband, and come hither. And the woman answered and said, I have no husband. And Jesus said unto her, Thou hast well said, I have no husband. For thou hast had five husbands, and he whom thou now hast is not thy husband. And that sayest thou truly. The woman saith unto him, Sir, I perceive that thou art a prophet. Our fathers worshipped in this mountain, and ye say that in Jerusalem is the place where men ought to worship. Jesus saith unto her, Woman, believe me, the hour cometh when ye shall neither in this mountain nor yet at Jerusalem worship the Father. Ye worship ye know not what. We know what we worship, for salvation is of the Jews. But the hour cometh, and now is, when the true worshipers shall worship the Father in spirit and in truth. For the Father seeketh such to worship him. God is a spirit, and they that worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth. And the woman saith unto him, I know that the Messiah is coming, which is called Christ. And when he is come, he will tell us all things. In verse 26, Jesus saith unto her, I that speak unto thee am he. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for your word tonight, for this story. We thank you for blessing us, for allowing us to speak your word. We pray you put your hand on us and that you'll use us in a mighty way. In Jesus' name, amen. So we see this story here of Jesus, and it says here in verse 4 that he made this, or the scripture says, and he must needs go through Samaria. Now he was leaving Judea and going to Galilee, but he must needs go through Samaria. I believe that Jesus, long before this story ever took place, knew that he would one day go through Samaria, and that he would one day meet this woman at the well. I believe it was appointed in time. I believe tonight, if you're saved and you're born again, that Jesus made an appointment with you to meet you somewhere, wherever he touched your heart and your life was changed and you gave your life to him. I believe that he knew this well in advance, that he must needs go through Samaria. So as we look at this story tonight, the first thing I want us to look at is the necessity of water and how important water is in our lives. I saw a documentary, it's been a few years ago, but I looked it up again just to refresh my mind on it. It was a guy that's a member of a tribe over in Africa. It was a guy that lived in the wilderness, and they had different ways of trying to find water. And on this documentary, it showed the different ways. The first way that he found some water was out in the desert. There would be some things growing. This looks like dead twigs to me, but there was different kinds, and he knew the ones to dig under. And so, sure enough, he went to this twig that was just dead, just sticking up out of the sand, and he began to dig under it. And he dug down in that sand as fast as he could, and there was a big bottom there, like a turnip green bottom, but it was much bigger. And he pulled it up out of the ground, and he took a sharp stick, and he scraped the skin off of it, and he scraped, and he got a handful of those shavings, and he would squeeze it real hard, and he would get just a few drops of water out of those shavings of that bottom of whatever kind of fruit or vegetable that was. And so that was one way they got just a little bit of water there. But there was another way that really intrigued me, how he went about finding water. Over there, of course, they have monkeys and all, and they had some baboons. And there was a baboon out there watching him one day. And they are very inquisitive and nosy little creatures. And so he took, it was kind of like a hollow log, and he made a hole in it. And he put some seeds in it from a fruit that he had eaten. And that baboon was watching him, and he kept wanting to go see what that was all about. So the man put that down in that hole, and he went and he hid in the brush and he watched. And sure enough, that baboon went down there, and he stuck his hand down in that hole in that log, and he grabbed the seeds. And when he did, he made a fist, and his fist would not fit back out of the hole. And he was trapped, and he was jumping around and screaming and hollering. And so he trapped that baboon. He went up and he put a rope around his neck. He tied him to a tree. And then they must have had some salt over there, because he had just like big hunks of salt. And he fed that salt to the baboon. And he tied him up overnight. And I thought it was pretty amazing. And the next morning he goes back, and the baboon has eaten all the salt, and he's dying of thirst. And he knows that this animal knows where water's at. And so he unties him. Sure enough, the baboon takes off running across the desert. He heads into the rocky hills there, some kind of some small mountainous type, real rugged terrain. But this guy, barefooted and all, chases after this baboon. And he runs through there, and he runs up the side of the mountain. And the baboon darts behind a big rock, and he loses sight of him. But he goes, he looks down in there, and there's a big room. And sure enough, there's a big pool of water there. And he finds him some good fresh water. And the baboon is down there, and he's drinking it up as fast as he can. I always thought that was a pretty neat story of how they go about finding water. And so back in this time, in the Bible times, water was scarce like this. These are desert areas. Water was important. In fact, water is important today. We take it for granted here in America because we have so much water. In fact, if you stop and think about many of our cities, especially our large cities in America, are founded right on the banks of a river. You know, you think about the cities in Louisiana, and you think about Shreveport, it's right there on what? The Red River. Monroe is on the banks of the Washita River, right? You go to New Orleans, and it's surrounded by water. It's everywhere down there. Baton Rouge is on the Mississippi. And so all, you know, Alexandria, it's on the Red River. And so a lot of our cities, all across the United States, that's where because water was important. It was a way to move things up and down the river. It was, you had plenty of water for the fields and the farms and all of that. And so water is a very necessary thing tonight. In fact, our bodies can go longer without food than we can go without water. We have to have water to survive. We need water for our plants, our trees, our livestock, and our animals. And so water is very important. It says that our bodies are 65% water. And you think about a fruit like a tomato, they say is 95% water. Much of the land in these parts of the world are desert lands. Their water wells are very important. We know that when Abraham was alive, they dug these wells there, and this well had been given to Jacob. It was known as Jacob's well. There's only 3% of the earth's water that is actually fresh water. The rest of it is oceans and seas, and it's salt water. And so only 3% is fresh water. Only 1/5 of the world's population have access today to safe drinking water. And I'm not so sure sometimes if we're not in that 1/5, right? I mean, just in Sunday school this morning, I got up and we meet over here in the fellowship hall, and I got me a cup of ice, and I hollered back at my class. I said, "Look, I'm fixing to drink some tap water." And they all went, "Ooh, don't do that," you know? We grew up drinking tap water, right? In fact, I remember being outside when we used to work outside, or whether we was playing in the hot summer, and there'd be a faucet on the back of the house, and there'd be a water hose attached, right? And you turn the water on, and I mean, the water that come out of there would burn you if you put your mouth down there or your hand or anything. And you'd have to let it run for a little while to cool that water hose off. And then you could finally get just a little bit of cool water. And we used to drink out of the water hose, and it tasted just like water hose, right? It had that old rubber taste, and it was awful. And we wonder why we have cancer today. But, we used to drink it where we could get it. It didn't matter. And now today we have bottled water. I'm not sure how old I was when bottled water. I think I was in my early 20s maybe. But I thought it was the craziest thing ever. Why would a man go into a convenience store and buy bottled water when all you had to do is get it out of the tap, you know? And now I got a truck full of bottled waters and a house full of bottled waters, and that's what we drink, you know. And so things have changed. But we take it for granted here in America about how much water we have, and we waste water like crazy, you know, and we just let it run and take 30-minute showers and all that. But it's not like that everywhere in the world. In fact, in some parts of the world, a water well is much more important than a gas well or an oil well. It's much more valuable. You see on Christian TV a lot of times these infomercials where they're asking for money, and they show these little children running around. They need water and they need food, and they're asking for money, and they'll tell you we're asking for money to drill a water well in these little villages and all. And some of these places they say travel up to 15 miles per day on foot just to get some water for their family. And so we here in America are quite spoiled, and we just take it for granted good cool water to drink. But in fact, in many places in the world today, it's not that way. So we see Jesus here. The Bible says that he was wearied from his travels. He had walked this distance. I'm not sure how far this was, but it's not like today when we just jump in a car and take off and go. He was going from Judea to Galilee, and he must needs go to Samaria. So he went there, and when he got there, the Bible says he was tired. It was noontime. It was probably hot, and he sat on this well, I'm thinking, because he knew this woman was coming, and he wanted to meet with her that day. And she came, sure enough, to draw water. And it's kind of unusual that she would come at noontime, because many times when they drew water back then, they would draw it either early in the morning or late in the evening. But she came at noon that day to draw water. And as she came, Jesus confronted her and asked her a simple question. Could you please draw me some water? Could you give me a drink of water? And this lady was astounded that Jesus not only asked for water, but that he would even speak to her. And she, quite frankly, told him, I can't believe you asked me for water. We don't have anything to do with y'all. Y'all don't have anything to do with us. And yet you're here and you're going to ask me for water. I'm from Samaria and you're a Jew. And you know, we just don't get along very well. And Jesus said, look, if you knew who you was talking to, you would ask me for some water. And she didn't quite understand that. And so their conversation continued. And Jesus began to tell her, go get your husband and come get this water. And I'll give you some water that if you'll drink it, you'll never thirst again. And she didn't understand that. She thought he was talking about physically. Jesus was speaking about spiritually. And she didn't understand. And she said, I don't have a husband. And he said, you're right. You've had five husbands. And the one that you're living with now is not your husband. And I just want to run a little rabbit right there if I can, as Brother Rube might say. There's a lot of folks today doing that same game. And it ain't nothing new. It's been going on for a long time. People living together and shacking up before they get married. And I'm here to tell you that it's not right. It'll never be right. And today, you know, when I was growing up, people did it and they knew it was a sin and they kind of felt bad about it, but they just did it anyway. Now, they don't even see it as a sin. Like, it's just nothing wrong with it. It's just natural. And they'll tell you, hey, that's just the way it is. And we're just getting used to each other. And if it don't work out, that way we're not married. Well, that's just a bunch of hogwash. It's wrong. And we ought not to be shacking up. And I'll tell my class that, and I'll tell it in the church, that it's a sin. God's still the same today as he was yesterday. And his word is true. And so we shouldn't be doing that. We shouldn't shack up and live together and be having sex before marriage. It's not right. And so here, Jesus confronts her with her sin. And he says, you've well said he's not your husband. You're living in sin. You've had five husbands, and now you're living the way you're living. And he confronts her, and then she responds, you must be a prophet. The title of my sermon tonight is When Jesus Passes By, Things Will Change. You know, we've had some good services here lately. The first night of our spring rally, I mean, the Lord moved. I mean, he moved. I'm not one to get up here and tell you my personal business, but I feel compelled to tonight to tell you that when I came to the altar that night, I just simply said, Lord, I surrender all. I give it all to you. God, you've called me to preach sometimes and fill in at Antioch. And Lord, when I go and preach, I don't want to just fill in. I don't want to just get by. I don't want to just have another slow Sunday night. Brother Rube's gone. Everybody relax and listen. No, I want to preach the word. I want you to use me the best I can, Lord. I want to be the best I can be. I don't want to just get by. And that's in my nature. And not that I compete with another preacher. That's not at all. But I just want to be the best I can be. Amen. And I think that's what we should do. And so I just come that night and I'll just say this. When Jesus passes by, things change. People change. And that night, people changed. People got saved. A lot of people in our church got right with God, confessed their sins. The next night was the same thing. Easter Sunday, man, it was great in here. It was packed out. We had to put chairs out there. And not only that, but the Lord moved. And people came and got saved. And today, again, this morning, people came, giving their heart to Christ, joining our church. Brother Jason surrendered to preach. Listen, God's moving at Antioch. Jesus has passed by several times lately. And as Brother Reuben mentioned, I almost got chills when he mentioned it during the invitation this morning because this was my sermon. I thought he was going to steal it. But look, Jesus has been passing by. And we need to get in on it because it ain't always this way. The Spirit don't always move in a church. And it's been moving here at Antioch. And I'm fired up and excited about that. And I got to be honest with you, and my family can tell you, when I came and said, Lord, I surrender all. I give it all to you. Man, Satan's been wearing me out. He's been working on me. And I hate that. But it's true. Brother Reuben's right. When you do, Brother Jason, when you surrender, and when they had my ordination service back here, Brother Wayne Whiteside mentioned to me. He came up to me and he said, look, I want to tell you something. He said, Satan's finna bear down on you, boy. You better be ready. And he's right. Anytime you're going to commit to God and to try to serve him and do his work, man, he'll wear you out. And you better be ready. You better get in his word and you better study it and you better let it give you strength because he will try to work on you and defeat you. And so here we are tonight. We see this story. This woman comes to the well. She is thirsty. She's going to get her some water. But I believe that Jesus knew that not only was she physically thirsty, but that she was spiritually thirsty. That she needed something. That's why he mentioned to her, hey, I can give you some water where you'll never thirst again. And we see there in verse 15, the woman saith unto him, sir, give me this water that I thirst not. Listen, if you're born again tonight, there's a time in your life when you said, Jesus, give me this water. I'll take it. Give it to me, Lord. I want it. I want to be born again. I want to be saved. You see, in this well that springs up in us, the only way I know to explain that is that when we're born again, he gives us this water that we never thirst again. And we may fall short. There may be times when we have sin in our life. But I believe when we do, that water wells up in us again, a new spring that refreshes us. It doesn't save us again. Once we're saved, we're saved. But it refreshes us. And the best way I can explain that is When I used to live up here, right down the road, we had a little over 4 acres I was mowing. And before I got a tractor, I had a little riding lawnmower. And man, by the time I, seemed like the time I got through mowing, it was time to start on the other side. I mean, it took a while. And we had a swimming pool in the backyard, and I would mow with my swimming trunks on with a tank top and just some Crocs or something. And I would mow a while, and I'd get real hot and dusty, and I'd go around to that swimming pool, and I'd kill that lawnmower, and I'd jump in that pool and cool off and wash all that dust away and that sweat, and it would be so refreshing. I'd done it 1,000 times if I'd done it once, and I just remember how refreshing that was. And as we look at that picture tonight, I think that's a picture of us as Jesus is talking about this well of water that springs into eternal life, everlasting life, and that we'll never thirst again. And when we get dirty and sinful in our lives, and even as Christians, that well of water keeps us fresh, and it gives us strength to continue on and to carry us on. The problem, I believe, today with many of our folks is that we're not thirsty. This woman came to the well, and she was thirsty spiritually. And I believe today that we see many of our folks that we try to win and we pray for is the fact that they're not thirsty. Before we can come to God and confess our sins, we have to have a thirst and a hunger for Him. We have to come to a place where we admit that we're lost before we can get saved. And I think today in our society, people just don't want anything to do with God. They're not thirsty for God. And even sometimes as the church, we're not thirsty for the Lord, for His word. And it's why we're weak, and we sometimes feel defeated, is because we don't have this thirst. But as this woman comes by and Jesus offers her this water that will supply for her forever, she finally says, "Give me this drink," and he does that. And then she goes on and she leaves there, and she goes and starts telling others what Jesus has done for her, and that he told me all that I ever did. And there, if you keep reading the story, there's a lot of people that come to Jesus because of her testimony. And I just want to say tonight that when Jesus passes by, when he truly comes by, things change. I remember another story of Jesus when he was on his way with a ruler to go heal his daughter. They came to him and said, "You know, this man's daughter is sick and he needs help." And so Jesus and the disciples and a great multitude of people took off. They were going to this house to heal this young lady. But on their way, there was another woman there. And she had heard that Jesus was coming through. And she had heard about the miracles he had performed. And she knew that maybe he could help her. And the Bible said that she had an issue of blood. She had been bleeding for 12 years. She couldn't stop the bleeding. The Bible said she spent all the money she had on physicians. And there was a statement in there that really caught my attention. It said that she had suffered many things, but only grew worse. And so this bleeding would not stop. And she bound to have been weak and sickly. And even then, with this blood condition, she was considered unclean. She was treated as somebody that may have leprosy or something. She was an outcast, and she was unclean, and people wouldn't have nothing to do with her. And she was there when she heard that Jesus was passing by. And when he passed by, the Bible says that she just reached out and touched the hem of his garment, and instantly she was made whole. Jesus stops, and he turns around, and he says, "Who touched me?" And the disciples were like, "Jesus, look at all these people. There's people all around you, and you're going to say, 'Who touched you?'" He said, "Somebody touched me, because I felt power leave me." And the woman was there. There was only two people there that knew what had happened. It was Jesus, and it was this woman. She comes forth, she bows down, and she said, "It was me, Lord. I touched you. I touched the hem of your garment. I knew if I could only just touch you that I would be healed, that I would be made whole." And he said, "You are healed." That was faith. That was faith. Just knowing that you could touch the hem of his garment and be made whole. You see, when Jesus passes by, things change. People change. There's another story of a man that was born blind. His name was Bartimaeus, and he was blind. And he also heard that Jesus was coming through. There was a great commotion, and Bartimaeus was out on the side. The Bible says he was a beggar. He was begging for food. You see, back in that day, there was no programs to help people that were blind or whatever, you know. And so he was on his own. And he was begging for food or money or anything he could get just to survive. And he heard that Jesus was coming through. And he too had heard about the miracles that this man had done. And it was his only hope. And as Jesus passed by, he said, "Who is that?" There was somebody standing. "Who is that?" And they said, "It's Jesus." And he cries out, "Jesus, Son of David, have mercy on me." And they said, "Bartimaeus, be quiet. You can't call on him. He ain't got time for you. Listen, this is Jesus. This is the Messiah." And the Bible says he cried even louder, "Jesus, Son of David, have mercy on me." And the Bible says that Jesus stopped and said, "Bring him to me." And they brought Bartimaeus to Jesus. And he said, "Young man, what can I do for you?" And he said, "Lord, that I might receive my sight." The Bible says that Jesus gave him his sight and he could see. Can you imagine how happy that man was to receive his sight? He'd been born blind. And just looking at people and seeing what they look like. It's an amazing thing. You see, when Jesus passes by, things change. People change. I want to encourage you tonight that Jesus has been passing by Antioch. He's been coming through here. Man, me and Reuben's been texting and we talk. And we want it to continue. And here's how to continue. If you pray, you keep praying. You keep praying for Brother Reuben. Keep praying for the services we have. Keep praying for Brother Ross as he leads the music. I'm serious. Prayer is the key to this thing. If we'll commit to it, if everybody in this room will commit to praying for our services and praying for lost people, praying for our neighbors and our family, God will continue to move in a mighty way. I don't believe we've seen anything yet if we'll commit to prayer. Amen. Brother Ross, I'm asking you to come. If you need to come tonight and drink of this water that Jesus offers, you come. I'm going to ask you to stand with us tonight.